Today, I'm happy to report that people are actually talking about the Federal Reserve again. Yay! As you know, I follow the Federal Reserve like Rachel Maddow followed the Mueller report. Whether it's shocking reports like, oh, they raised the key interest rate by a quarter of a percentage point, or even more scandalously, oh, they didn't raise the key interest rate by a quarter of a percentage point. Yep, I'm watching them like a hawk watches. Well, something that I bet 99% of people rarely care or think about. So why are people talking about the Fed today? Did Fed chairman and whitest man to be named Jerome Powell, walk off the set of a Brooks Brothers photo shoot and decide to raise rates by a quarter of a percentage point? No. People are worried about a recent and well-documented history of Trump bashing him coming to a head. Right now, Jerome finds himself in an almost sitcom position because...
Can the president fire you?
Well, the law is clear that I have a 4-year term and I fully intend to serve it.
So no, in your view?
No.
So he just keeps showing up to work despite the fact that his boss hates him. Hey, legally, you can't fire me. So what's the beef? Because we've heard all varieties of Trump insults against the Fed, including my personal favorite...
The Fed is going loco, and there's no reason for them to do it, and I'm not happy about it.
I don't even know what to say right there. I've never heard a more boring person get called loco since Jim from accounting decided to have a second beer at the office Christmas party. Now, I'll link to a few episodes at the end where I talk about how the sausage actually gets made, but for the purposes of today, the Federal Reserve is the part of the government dedicated to longer-term economic planning. The goal is to make sure our economy doesn't get too good or too bad. And yes, leave it to economists to start panicking that the economy is too good. When the economy starts getting too good, the Fed raises rates so that people start to spend less and save more. And when the economy gets bad, the Fed lowers the rates so people take that money that they were saving and spend. Basically, that's why when you're in a bad economy, the most valuable thing you'll get from your savings account is the free toaster they give you for opening it. The problem here is, well, here's Trump explaining a recent economic slowdown.
The reason is interest rates have gone up because our Federal Reserve is raising rates too fast because they think our economy is too good. And I say, I don't want you to, every time we announce a good quarter, you have to raise interest rates. I don't want that. I'm very unhappy with the Federal Reserve.
Wow, the Fed thinks the economy is too good. It's almost like they've ever seen a Trump speech. So Trump wants the rates to stay low so that people continue to not save, take out loans, and spend money. Problem is, the guy who he nominated and can't fire very much disagrees with him. While he has recently cut down on the number of proposed future rate hikes, he still operates independently from the president's wishes. Which, and this is not an opinion, is one of the core tenets of the Fed. Problem is, if the Fed works for the leaders, well, no politician is ever going to say, you know what, we need lower growth so that when the economy levels off in a few years, we have something to fall back on. We recently saw this exact problem happen in Turkey.
The Turkish president brings his son-in-law onto the stage. Berat Albayrak is Turkey's new treasury and finance minister.
Yeah, the president's son-in-law became the head of the Federal Reserve. Insert Jared Kushner joke here. Problem was, well, when your father-in-law is the head of the country, it's hard to say, let's slow down the economy to a reasonable pace. The economy was fine and the central bank kept the interest rates low so that people would continue to not save and spend more. Because, ooh, my savings account is offering a quarter of a percent interest. That means every $1,000 I put in, I get a quarter. So people were spending that money. The economy was going well. Hey, you can get a loan for as little money as possible as well. Because rates are so low, why not take out some money to buy things? Then their currency started to lose its value because everyone had more money, so they were more willing to spend money to get the same things. So of course sellers are going to start boosting prices. And because of that, the currency loses value and inflation happens. Unfortunately, at Erdogan's urging, the Fed didn't change the rates to say, hey, maybe we should start saving because Erdogan wanted people spending, saying things like, debt is the mother of all evil. Which, talk about a hard sell, I mean, death to Israel, death to America, death to the central bank raising interest rates. He even declared the central bank interest rate increases as treasonous, which, wow, talk about a power play to put your son-in-law in his place. So because of this, we soon saw...
Turkish lira is in meltdown. It's lost around a quarter of its value against the US dollar this month and around 45% so far this year. The country's central bank has moved to calm the storm, making short-term credit more easily available. However, there's been no sign of a hike in interest rates.
Wow, still not raising rates? I respect your dedication. If you want to know more, I made an episode all about this. Link at the end. This outcome is consistent with, well, exactly what macroeconomics teaches will happen if you don't have an independent Fed. This is why people are worried today, though. Because two seats just opened up for the Federal Reserve board members, and people are worried that Trump will appoint yes men. You know, like...
We interrupt to take you to the White House, where President Trump is about to nominate Federal Reserve board member Jerome Powell to replace Janet Yellen.
Well, not that time. But fool me once, shame on you. I'm gonna try to take these nominees, Stephen Moore and Herman Cain, on merit, and just show how they're gonna think and vote on the Fed. Although, boy oh boy, do they look like a billboard perfect pair of personal injury lawyers. If this whole nomination doesn't work out... Let's start with Herman Cain, because, well, he actually was the deputy chair of the Kansas City Fed from 1992 to 1994, and then chair of that Fed from 1994 to 1996. Now, I don't want to say that working at a regional Fed as a chairman equates directly to what he'd be doing here. From what I've read, local Fed officials operate as data collectors, monitors for the local economy, and don't have much of a voice in setting national interest rates. So, alright, it was more like an internship for the Fed. Just enter the data and answer the phone if it rings. It still gives us some insight into his mentality and means he's had some exposure to the Federal Reserve System, though. Reuters got a hold of some of the minutes of conversation between Herman Cain and the Kansas City Fed president, a man whose job it is to actually attend quarterly meetings to discuss setting national federal rates. The concern, according to those minutes, was that continued economic growth could produce price pressures that needed to be constrained by tighter monetary policy. Basically, the Fed needed to combat the Turkish knot delight we were talking about earlier, of people with more money spending more to push up prices. To get a little perspective on all this, we can go back and contextualize it by looking at 1985. First though, I gotta do a few stretches because it's about to get cramped up in here. The dreaded full screen!
The commercial real estate collapse of the late 1980s required a heavy dose of monetary ease beginning in 1989 to alleviate a significant credit crunch. The danger of overstaying that policy of ease was clear, particularly as we moved through 1993, but the right time to change course was quite difficult to judge.
Yeah, wow, totally different problems to today, right? According to those minutes, Herman Cain's Federal Reserve was, and this may seem odd considering everything we've talked about so far, worried that the economy was doing too well, and that inflation was going to start really kicking into gear. This is of course because prices would go up as people had more money to burn, and therefore were more willing to spend more money on these same items. So in another great economy that we find ourselves in today, he might sound like Trump's nightmare 2.0, right? I mean, you don't want to appoint another Jerome Powell. Well, our economy is strange right now. I did an episode about this if you're curious. But if your primary driver is inflation, something that generally kicks in when the economy is hot, well, it's not happening right now, and nobody's sure why.
A confused Fed, some really long minutes and no agreement on anything. And a bit earlier, we talked about how they were the victim of their own transparency. I imagine this is a debate they don't really want playing out in public.
Yeah, it's a weird time to be at the Federal Reserve right now. This is why you could get things like Cain in February told Fox Business News he believed deflation is a bigger worry. This worry could lead to potentially more economic stimulus from the Fed, as opposed to tightening. And that might sound crazy, but if you look at the charts, What the hell is going on? Seriously, I feel like I'm in a particularly boring episode of The Twilight Zone right now. I'll sum up this Herman Cain section with a clip from MSNBC.
He ran a pizza chain. He was on the board of directors for the Fed Board of Kansas City. So he's had some experience with the system. He ran for president, remember? He's also advocated going back to the gold standard.
Yeah.
So, I don't know.
Yeah, we don't know. This brings us to Stephen Moore, which, yeah, I might know with this one. It's never a bad sign when this is an interview question.
Speaking of working with the chairman, you suggested a couple of months ago that Chairman Jay Powell be fired and that the rest of the Federal Reserve should be let go for monetary policy incompetence. And you called the Fed the swamp in Washington. Are you going to be able to work with these people?
Wow. I do not want to lump Herman Cain in with this guy. Because while Herman Cain has his clear issues, I think you could make at least an argument that he has some experience and knows the basics. This guy recently said, I'm kinda new to the game, frankly, so I'm gonna be on a steep learning curve myself about how the Fed operates, how the Federal Reserve makes its decisions. Yeah, the pushback against this guy has been swift, with George Bush's chairman of the White House Council of Economic Advisers saying he does not have the intellectual gravitas for this important job. It's time for senators to do their job. Mr. Moore should not be confirmed. I mean, tell me what you really think. I can't tell you much about his monetary policy philosophy because he has zero experience in that area. But I can play you a clip that I think sums it up best.
I consider myself a growth hawk, so I think what I will really try to pursue and persuade the chairman of and work with the chairman to try to make sure that the America grows as fast as it can.
Yeah, so drop rates and get maximum short-term growth. A great economic policy to hear from that guy at the bar sitting next to you, but not so much from a potential Fed nominee. Think of it this way, the economy is like a car. You can keep going faster and faster, and why would you put speed limits up? I mean, if I'm doing 150, I can get there a lot faster. Well, partially because if you crash, well then the only thing your seatbelt's determining is whether the paramedics find you in one piece or two. If the low rates keep people borrowing, spending, and not saving, you get risks of bubbles, lack of safety nets, and of course that stimulus of spend, spend, spend when you lower the rates. Although there's also the inflation issue, but I'm having trouble arguing that last point right now considering this economy is weird as heck. So now to the important point. How important are these two appointments? Well, here's the current Federal Reserve Board. As you can see, 2/7 of the board are up for nomination. And that's quite the voting block if these nominees do end up being Trump loyalists, like many people allege they are. One thing I want to make clear is that both of these candidates are a radical departure from the norm as far as experience. The next step is to see whether the Senate confirms either or both of these two prospective candidates, at which point we might see a healthy coalition in the Fed of pushing stimulus of this amazing economy, essentially giving the overstimulated kid a cup of espresso. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hey YouTube, here are the two videos I mentioned. Here's Turkey, and here's Where's the Inflation, a whodunit episode. If you want to support independent, nonpartisan news, remember to subscribe by clicking on this floating logo to the left of my head. Ring that bell so the freedom will continue to ring, and give me a thumbs up if you like what you saw. Lastly, as always, thank you for watching.